Thank you. Thank you. Good morning, and welcome to the 57th commencement ceremonies of Wheeling Jesuit University. My name is Robert Phillips, and it is my privilege to serve this university as her Vice President of Academic Affairs. I will be the Master of Ceremonies for today's graduation festivities. Will you please stand and remove your caps for the singing of the National Anthem and the Alma Mater, led by the Symphonic Band, WJU Chamber Singers, and the Music Ministry Choir. Please remain standing for the invocation given by Father William Rickel, S.J., Senior Vice President for Mission and Ministry at Wheeling Jesuit University.
Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, known by many names and heard in many voices, we invoke your presence this day. Today we celebrate the accomplishments of those who receive diplomas, of those who begin new chapters in their lives. We invoke your blessings upon them. There are those here who have passed through Wheeling Jesuit University and seldom looked to right or left, who seem to have just sailed through their time here with nary a bump nor contusion. There are those here who have struggled and arrive here today slightly battered and bruised, relieved just to be here. Make each one mindful, we pray, of what they've accomplished. Let success mend self-esteem and give perspective to achievement. Bless as well those who have supported them in their work, in the classroom, at home, and on the way. Teachers who have given of themselves in many ways that will only be understood with the passage of time. Staff and administrators who have labored behind the scenes for their success. Families who have sacrificed much. Friends who learned from them and taught them as only peers can. Make us ever mindful of those on whose shoulders we stand, as well as those who follow in our path. Above all, Lord God, we ask that your Holy Spirit continue to inspire, guide, and draw our graduates further into a life of joyful service of others, constantly searching for truth and justice, and longing after that peace which the world cannot give. Even as we celebrate accomplishment and transition, may we continue to seek your holy wisdom. Lord, we ask you, hear our prayer. Amen.
Please be seated. It is my honor and privilege to introduce Reverend James J. Fleming, S.J., the president of Wheeling Jesuit University. Please join me in welcoming President Fleming.
In worship and in pray and play, in the pronounced unwillingness of this community to be satisfied with power as an answer to the world's problems, and in its steadfast hope that human structures can be made more just, more humane, more open to the transcendent possibilities of the human spirit in all its potential. We say, okay, but what if? So we wear our caps and gowns, our honors tassels, our Kairos crosses, our rainbow flags, our American flags, to remind ourselves not who we are, but who we can become. And we dare to dream. But be forewarned, in dreams are born responsibilities. Congratulations.
Mrs. Sarah Kelly, Vice President for Advancement, will now introduce our honorary degree recipient.
Would the candidate for Doctor of Humane Letters please come forward? Margaret Mimi O'Hara Helm, alumna of Wheeling College, class of 1984, mother and wife, community leader, and dedicated chair of the Wheeling Jesuit University Board of Trustees. In her care for her family, in her attentiveness to those in need, in her generosity of spirit as a benefactor and board
member. Nan, also a WJU alum, on campus when they were both undergraduates. Wheeling Jesuit University's only alum currently serving as a member of Congress, Representative Murphy earned a master's degree from Cleveland State University and a doctorate from the University of Pittsburgh. Congressman Murphy holds a senior position on the House Energy and Commerce Committee as Chairman of Oversight and Investigations. He also serves as the co-chair of the Mental Health Caucus and was a founding member of the GOP Doctors Caucus, a position which he uses to educate other members of Congress and the public on ways to make healthcare more affordable and accessible to families. In addition to his work on Capitol Hill, Lieutenant Commander Murphy serves in the Navy Reserve Medical Service Corps as a psychologist with service members with traumatic brain injury and post-traumatic stress at Walter Reed National Military Medical Center in Bethesda, Maryland. It is my honor to present to you a man whose life embodies the mission of Wheeling Jesuit University, educating for life, leadership, and service, the Honorable Timothy Murphy.
Thank you. Well, it's great to be back here. I remember the days when we didn't have a gym and I was in a band and I played guitar in the old gym or up in Swint Hall. I was in our drama group called the Caviar Club. I don't know where the name came from, but playing Macbeth. Or thank goodness in those days we did not have cell phones to take pictures when I played Oberon, King of the Fairies in Midsummer Night's Dream. There's something to be said for getting away with wearing black tights, but I digress. Happy Mother's Day to all the mothers, and to the students, yeah. It's a nice present for your parents to graduate. This is good. All their money is not for want. However, they all stood when you came in the room. May I suggest you give your parents a standing ovation? Yeah. Good job. Now, we're feeling pretty good. We're feeling fine. I want to tell you a little about feeling fine as relative. So, Seamus, an Irishman, was on trial in Dublin for insurance fraud. And counsel was interrogating him and said, "Seamus, here you are on insurance fraud, and isn't it true on the day in question, when the police officer, known as the Garda, came up to you and said, 'How you feeling?' You said you were feeling fine, and now here you are making these claims of all of these injuries. What do you have to say for yourself?" Seamus said, "Your Honor, if I may speak, you see, on the day in question, I took my best milking cow, Elizabeth, and I put her on a trailer, and I was taking her into town to sell her." That's got nothing to do with what you're here for, Seamus. Tell the truth. Isn't it true on the day in question you said you were feeling fine? Nobody cares about your milking cow. "Your Honor, if I could continue," said Seamus. "I had Elizabeth on the trailer, driving her into town, when suddenly a truck comes through the intersection at the roundabout and crashes into us." "That's it," said counsel. "Your Honor, make him answer the question I've given him." To which the judge says, "Seamus, I'm interested in your cow. What happened?" "Thank you, Your Honor. A fine man indeed you are to recognize a good milker. So there we were. The truck came by and hit the trailer. Old Elizabeth, she gets spun in the air, does several somersaults, lands in a ditch on one side of the road. I'm in a ditch on the other. We're both battered, bruised, and broken. I see her there out of the corner of my swollen eye with blood coming out of my forehead. And I hear her mooing and wailing. Oh, it was a sad thing indeed. And after a while, along down the road comes the Garda, and he gets out of his car, and of course he hears Elizabeth first because of her loud moans. He says, 'Oh, you poor cow, you look miserable. I'll put you out of your misery,' and takes out a gun and he blows her brains out. And then he sees me on the other side of the road, and with his hot gun still in his hand, he says, 'Seamus, how are you feeling?' I said I was feeling fine." It's relative. You know, speaking at a graduation is a great honor. You hope to say something meaningful and inspiring and lasting, or at least I want to say something meaningful and inspiring and lasting. You want to get out of here. So, but please give me a few moments to pass on some lessons that I learned from being a student here at Wheeling and on in life. Now, you all may remember the movie Saving Private Ryan, right? Tom Hanks, remember his last words? "Earn this." After traveling through Europe, trying to find one Private Ryan so he could be reunited with his mother, so many of his squad were killed trying to do that. But it's kind of like when Xavier was told by Ignatius, "I need you to go to the East and I want you to convert people out there." Ignatius didn't say, I don't know the language, I don't have the right clothes, and my gosh, I don't have an app for that, what am I going to do? He just said, okay, let's go. Now, I don't want to mean to sound insensitive or incompassionate, but what parent that loves their children would sometimes say, you're going to learn to swim and I'm going to throw you in the water? Well, you can't be the weak link because the chain is only as strong as that weakest link. So if you think you can't, you can't. If you think you might, maybe. But if you say you will, you will. Number two, do something worthy of your time and your talent. Do something of your work, your learning, your education. Maybe you could build a building. Maybe you can teach another generation. Maybe you could be of service to your community. Maybe you'll have a new discovery. But whatever that will be, it will make more sense if you follow things in the Jesuit tradition. Question the impact of your work. I drive my colleagues crazy all the time. And I didn't really understand this till some years later I read Chris Lowney's book, Heroic Leadership. And after 4 years of Jesuit high school and 4 years of Jesuit education, I said, oy, that's what they were trying to teach me. Question, discern, think about it. What is the impact of what you do? Good intentions don't necessarily yield good results. Let me give you two examples. Anybody here in pre-med or nursing? All right. Can you name the vital signs? What are they? Someone stand up and shout it out. Come on. You can't name them? What are they? Pain. Yes, that's it. Thank you. All right. Good. It works, see? Now, let me tell you what happened. In 2004, when the American Medical Association and others said, we need to have pain as a vital sign. Made sense. Then what happened is they said, if physicians who don't ask and nurses who don't ask about pain are really committing malpractice. You don't want to send a patient home in pain. But what happened was, they didn't think of the consequences. You know, now when someone goes to an emergency room, they grace and as you just take care of the pain and ship them out. So there I am in some field. Next thing you know, I'm in an ambulance, then I'm in a helicopter, and everybody's always asking me, are you in pain? On a scale of 1 to 10, where are you? And I had a concussion, too, and I was saying, I don't know. I think 8, I don't know, 9, I hurt. And so, I didn't realize, give more morphine, slap a fentanyl patch on him, take this Oxycontin, try some of this Percocet, here's a Tylenol just to be good measure. And that continued on, and after a couple weeks, and I'm totally loopy and back in the United States, couldn't think straight, and I said, what am I on? And I just ripped the fentanyl patch off, stopped taking the medication, and you have a withdrawal reaction because your body gets used to that. But be careful what you do because it has consequences, because unfortunately a lot of people out there are getting worse. Here's another thing. I remember when I was a student, I did a little internship at that time at a little psychiatric hospital called Roney's Point. I don't even know if it still exists. At that time, we had a lot of psychiatric hospitals we were trying to empty out. Because we realized these places that may have begun as homes of compassion to take care of the mentally ill became dumping grounds, asylums. People were locked up and abused. And so we emptied them out. But what happened? We didn't take care of them. We ended up with places that for care for people that really became worse. Because we said people have a right to refuse care. We forgot to say they have a right to get treatment. So what happens? 40 to 60% of people in prisons are mentally ill. The vast majority of people who are homeless, mentally ill. A huge proportion of those who visit emergency rooms in crisis, mentally ill. And our cemeteries are filled with the 40,000 people who died last year of suicide. We have to think of the consequences of how things are connected. But in so doing, and that's part of the Jesuit tradition, you realize that if you take your talent and your time and question and do something worthwhile, you can make a big difference. I want you to be that person at work who is sometimes the pain in the neck and saying, hey, wait a minute, I don't know if we should do this. It may have unforeseen consequences. You should be that person. You should be so lucky. It's a good thing to do as a Jesuit student. Number three. Learn real life skills for which there is no app. Now, I was amazed the other day. I was with someone and I said, do you know anything about the weather? Person took out cell phone, began typing in right away, pulled up weather maps, temperature, humidity, and wind, and was struggling. Says, it's not working. What do you mean? I can't tell. I said, here's an idea. Look out the window. And I was for a walk with this young man, and I said, do you know anything about how to tell the weather? By looking at the clouds, by smelling the air, by doing anything like that? He said, no, I don't know. So it's important to learn real-life skills, how to change a spark plug or change the oil on your lawnmower. I told my son-in-law before he got married I was going to give him a test on these things. He got very panicked. I don't know how to change the oil, he said. You'll be okay. I'll walk you through this. But the issue is here to learn those real life skills so you know what happens as being a leader when you can really do those things. It becomes part of how people will see you as really having a solid education and not just something you can swing by on. You'll also then be able to know what is right and wrong, because your eyes will be up here, not down here. You'll know that. You'll be able to understand when things are wrong, when people have acted wrong. So, work on that. Number four, have a strong faith and grow in that faith every day and make that your moral compass. You know, in the statuary hall at the U.S. Capitol, if any of you have ever been there, it's the old house chamber. It's filled with statues of great Americans, great leaders. It's amazing history in that room. John Quincy Adams' seat was there. Abraham Lincoln's seat was there. And several other people that went on to be presidents of the United States. It shows where they were. Can you imagine the echoes in that room of their debates as they stood and debated everything from slavery to shipping agreements to deals with other countries? It's also, with the statues there, it's encircled by people who, men and women, who've led our nation to great accomplishments in law, science, education, justice, and religion. And we're in awe of their actions. Some stood up and fought for freedom as soldiers. And there's one woman there who sat down on a bus and said, I'm not moving because of freedom. But the sum of all their accomplishments at 10 times 10 times 10 pale in comparison to what God calls you to do. What he asks you to do is not easy, and you should ask God to not give you an easy task. We pray and reach out to those whose lives are empty and meaningless, for the lost, the least, the last, and the lonely. And that is a responsibility you have. Not pity. Nobody can eat on pity. Nobody can be stronger on pity. It is up to you to be the best you can so that you can reach out with a hand of strength to lift them up, to serve the Lord not just with words, but through the gospel of action. That's your duty, by being the best and strongest you can be. When we answer that call, we're always reminded of how weak we are. I know in the House of Representatives, a lot of times people call upon us and say, pass this law, do this, do that. Sometimes I say something that's politically incorrect and say, can you do it yourself? And I literally had someone say to me, I want you to call the local community because this sign out here has got grass all around it and they really ought to plant some flowers and make it look nice. I said, why don't you do it? Get a weed whacker out there, dig it up, plant some flowers, do it yourself. He didn't like my comment, but it seems to me it would have made a lot more sense for him to step and be part of the community. And recognize in Congress what we cannot do is we cannot legislate character, we cannot mandate conscience, and we cannot litigate compassion. You have to do that, and you're called by your faith to do that. We have to acknowledge our own doubt, our own ignorance. Self-assuredness is something that makes us blind. But through hope, there is light. Through humility, there is strength. Through prayer, there is courage. Through faith, wisdom, and through grace, joy. So call upon the Lord to help you seek the answers to the questions that are still puzzling us, to find new roads in a light that is often so dim you can barely see, to be strengthened by God in that darkness and ask for guidance towards new solutions, towards the unknown horizons and that new tomorrow. Challenge yourself in these issues, no matter how high the mountains or how low the valleys. Stay focused on what is important. And while others may tempt you and get sidetracked and go other ways, you've got to make this your fundamental choice every day. So, you want to experience real joy? Serve the Lord. And it is when you make that choice and you say out loud, "As for me and my house, I will serve the Lord," and you do that for the greater glory of God, ad maiorem Dei gloriam, now you are a Jesuit student. So, let me bring this around to another point, because things are connected, sometimes in ways we don't understand. Two men are out hunting in the field, and while hunting through this field, they come to the edge of the woods, and they see a sinkhole. And one of them says, "That's a pretty deep hole." He picks up a rock, throws it in. He doesn't hear anything. "That's a very deep hole. I'm a little worried about this." He starts to walk away. Another said, "Wait a minute. Here's an anvil. Let's pick up this anvil together. We'll throw it in the hole and see if we can hear it." So they picked up this anvil, dropped in the hole, and listened. Nothing. "This is scary," they said. "Back away." So they backed away. And a few seconds later, this goat comes charging through the field at high speed, 30, 40, he must be doing 50 miles an hour, comes, jumps into that hole, and is gone. The hunters say, "This is too weird. Let's just get out of here." And they're walking back through the field, and they see a farmer scratching his head and says, "Have y'all seen my goat?" They said, "Hey, we just saw a goat running through the field, a white goat with horns." Yeah, that's him. "He just jumped down into this big sinkhole. We couldn't believe it." He said, "Couldn't have been. I had him tied to an anvil." And now back to our show. Point number 5. Be courageous. Be courageous. Fight back. Our faith is under attack. Our culture is under attack. Our families are under attack. We're not just transitioning. People are looking to destroy the things you learned and the values you seek. There are those who will mock your strength, who tell you that your focus on doing what is right is actually wrong. They'll continue unless you stand up. Anger and hate can lead a person to push someone else in front of a train. Courage and love can lead you to be the one that jumps in front of that train to save a life. Greater love hath no man. Now, it's not going to be easy, but please don't sit this one out. Stand up for your family, for your country. Don't just watch. You can't philosophize through this. Fight back. And if you think you don't have the courage, let me tell you this. So I'm a Navy Reserve officer. He said I work at Walter Reed Hospital on a unit, an inpatient unit for people with traumatic brain injury and post-traumatic stress disorder. And I've seen too many people wounded, missing eyes and parts of their brain and arms and legs. I've gone to too many funerals. And besides, speaking up, would you do me a favor? Next time someone's singing the alma mater and you see the person next to you not like this, give them a little nudge and say, "Put your hand up there." People died for that. The least you can do is this. Just a reminder. Be courageous and tell people that. So what happens sometimes, I don't know how many times, but happens too often than not, when a soldier comes back pretty severely wounded, sometimes girlfriend or boyfriend will say, "Hey, I'm not in on this. I'm out of here." I have seen cases where someone walks away from their spouse, takes the car, cleans out the bank account, takes the kids away, and they abandon someone after someone has given so much. And so I worry sometimes. I understand here, I've never happened to me here, but I understand it's an overwhelming thing when this happens to you. Well, one time I was working with a soldier who had a terrible head wound in his left hemisphere. And I was talking to his wife, a lovely young lady, about the consequences of this. And I was describing to her what had happened and what would happen. Now imagine yourself in this position that you are his spouse. Think about this. I said, "You know, from the IED blast, he got an injury to his frontal lobe. His personality has changed. Some of it's coming back. I don't know how soon or how much, but there's differences about him. And because it also affected his temporal lobe, his Wernicke's areas, and his Broca's area, he speaks with a strange speech, sort of like someone who has had a stroke. It's hard to understand. He struggles to pronounce words, but you notice he's getting better. And I don't know how soon or how much, but he'll improve. And because the parts of his temporal lobe that also affect understanding speech, he can't understand sarcasm or satire or metaphors. He has to be very concrete. He's getting better, and I don't know how much, and I don't know how soon, but we'll continue to work with him to find improvement. But it's not done. And his parietal lobe, it left him hemiplegic. He had just recently learned to stand up again and take steps. His right hand wouldn't zip a zipper again, would never write again, wouldn't button a button, couldn't shave, couldn't brush his teeth. But, said his left hand will take over. He'll improve. And we'll do everything we can to help him be the best that he can. Now imagine hearing that. As tears welled in her eyes, she said, you know, I don't mean to sound insensitive, but I'm jealous of those wives whose husbands don't come home because they can start over. So I mean no harm here, and I'm glad he's home. But I sent this handsome young soldier to war, and I don't know who this man is that came back with his name. I don't know him. Now, tears are in my eyes, too, and I'm fearing the worst. And I said, what will you do? She sat up a little straighter, put her shoulders back, and said, I made that decision on my wedding day. And she said, if it takes me 50 years, I will teach him to laugh and to love again. That is courage under fire. When someone goes into battle, they hope they don't hear the bullets overhead. They hope they don't take one. But think about her life. Every morning when she gets up, every day, and every night when she goes to bed, will her husband have seizures? What problems will he have in the morning? But she has not abandoned him. Let her be your hero, or find a hero that's better. And understand in those moments of courage, you have to be the one to stand up, to say, this isn't right, I'm not going to do that, I'm taking this path, I'm using prayer, I'm sucking up and I'm moving forward. We cannot comfortably sneak back into our corners. We have to run towards the cries of those who need help. You have to march towards that sound of the bugle that's telling you what is the location of that battle. Not to do that which is easy, but to purposely choose that which is difficult. There is a horizon out there, and it is yours. Set your sails, mark your compass, and go get it before your last breath. God bless.
At this time, Mr. Christopher Helmrath, Chair of the Board of Trustees, will share with us greetings from the Board.
Good morning, graduates, faculty, staff, parents, family, and friends. As the Chairman of the Board of Trustees of Wheeling Jesuit University, and on behalf of my fellow Board of Trustee members who are here today, I would like to offer our congratulations to all of our graduates from the entire board. We have three very distinct groups of people here today, and I'd like to highlight each. As Congressman did, we have most of you in the room, parents, family, friends, supporters. Moms, happy Mother's Day. for all of those laundry moments that you had, the trips to get these graduates where they needed to be on their way when they were small. It pays off. Congratulations. The formative years that you gave them and brought them to Wheeling, you entrusted us with their education at that point. And with that, I wish to highlight our other distinct group of folks that are here today. If you look to my right and to my left, the people that get to wear the great colorful outfits are our faculty, staff, and administration. These dedicated men and women have given their lives to educating your family members, our graduates, and have prepared them to be our leaders of tomorrow, whether they become teachers, nurses, therapists, lawyers, doctors, or politicians. Students, please join me in congratulating these very special people for allowing you the opportunity to go on in your lives to do what you're going to do. Apple hasn't invented an app for that yet. It takes the dedication of these men and women that have provided the education, and you have no idea how hard they work. We do, and we are grateful. And now on to our graduates. What an impressive group. And you can see that in your programs. Some of you as parents saw your students glide to the top, and I'm sure some of you as parents were like, please make their name in the brochure that they made it. An impressive statistic amongst these fine young men and women that are in front of me, almost one out of three are the first members of their family to graduate from college, and that's an impressive statistic. So graduates, you've been educated in the Jesuit charism, and we hope that you will carry this mission with you for the rest of your lives, being men and women for others. St. Ignatius began the Jesuit order in 1540, and the principles that were the basis of the order then are the same principles that have been taught to you here at Wheeling Jesuit University. 475 years of history has positioned you well for the success as leaders in serving your local communities in our world. You are the reason we are here as a university, and you are the reason that we serve on the Board of Trustees. We wish all of you well as you enter the new chapters in your lives. We ask that you keep this place, your alma mater, and its mission close to your heart. Ad maiorem Dei gloriam, for the greater glory of God.
Father Edward Gannon, S.J., was one of the first professors at Wheeling College. His demanding yet nurturing style of teaching epitomizes cura personalis, which is the goal of the exceptional faculty at Wheeling Jesuit University. The Outstanding Teacher Award is named in his honor. It gives me great pleasure to announce this year's Gannon Outstanding Teacher Award. The recipient is Dr. Daniel Weimer, Associate Professor of History.
Professor Emeritus is a title which honors those who have made a distinguished contribution to the academic life of the university over a number of years. We are pleased today to have two members of our faculty who have been appointed by President Fleming to receive this honor upon the recommendation of their departmental colleagues, the Faculty Council, and the Academic Vice President. The first faculty member who is with us today is Professor Kathleen L. Sullivan, Professor Emerita of Accountancy. And the second faculty member who is able to join us today is Professor Charles A. Millick, Professor Emeritus of Management. Will all of the candidates for bachelor's, master's, and doctor of physical therapy degrees please rise? Everybody must stand. This is the final test. President Fleming, in the name of the faculty of Wheeling Jesuit University, I present to you the candidates for degrees in the class of 2015. I certify that they have completed or are scheduled to complete the respective requirements for the degrees as listed in the program.
I further certify that by virtue of the degree-granting power vested in this corporation by the State of West Virginia, the Board of Trustees of Wheeling Jesuit University has duly approved the granting of said degrees to the candidates on the official list and those on the honorary degrees. Congratulations.
Now, will all of the candidates please be seated? Graduation honors are awarded to those undergraduates who have completed at Wheeling Jesuit University a minimum of 60 of the 120 hours of coursework required for graduation and achieved a cumulative average of 3.85 out of a possible 4.0 for summa cum laude, a 3.7 for magna cum laude, and at least a 3.5 for cum laude. Those undergraduates who have completed between 30 and 60 hours of coursework at Wheeling Jesuit University and have achieved a cumulative average of at least 3.5 are awarded their degree with distinction. The names of those students graduating in absentia appear in the program but will not be read. We will begin with the doctoral candidates. Please rise and come forward as the ushers indicate your row. Will the first row please rise and come forward? The Doctor of Physical Therapy degree has been earned by the following students. Douglas Arnold Atkins. Corey Allen. Amanda L. Althaus. Jeffrey Brian Backstrom. Casey Diane Berry. Jonathan W. Ebert. Aaron Ellis. Alexis Marie Franks. Elena Renee George. Danielle Catherine Gilmore. Leslie Hastings. Sarah Elizabeth Holmes. Marcus Johnson. Erica Christine Quito. Max Aaron King. Anne Julie Nicole Nolinger. Clayton Thomas Kubrick. Olivia Lent. Nicholas Lopez. Brianne Elizabeth Lucas. David Lee Neven III. Naomi Kathleen Neitz. Alyssa Marie Offit. Ross Michael Palicka. Leah Treasure Ridgway. Andrew Robinson. Ryan Eric Saylor. Christy Lynn Schenefelt. Chelsea Marie Shepherd. Jared Charles Smith. Jessica Suzanne Stewart. Kyle Updike. Autumn Francine Webster. Shelby Judith Leah Zielinski. The Master's of Arts in Education degree has been earned by the following students: William B. Anderson, Tal Bayer, Daniel L. Brosnan, Brian M. DeCola, Erica Rayanne Graffius, Gregory Lee Rothwell, Jason W. Skanes, The Master of Business Administration degree has been earned by the following students: Jennifer Glenn Elias, Austin Grimes, Xiao Jali, Mark James McIntosh, Sean A. Moore, Jared David Riccadonna, Scott R. Russell, Shelley L. Thomas, The Master of Science in Accountancy degree has been earned by the following students: Allison Marie Miller, Victoria Sponholz, The Master of Science in Nursing degree has been earned by the following students: Brandy Nicole Baileys, Lloyd A. B. Jr., Heather Deeney Brown, Stephanie Lynn Carmelo, Allison Dawn Chambers, Angela M. Cole, Jacob R. Corbin, Terry Lee Dye, Stephanie M. Foster, Sherry Lynn Gongawer. Bonnie Jean Konasek. Skylar V. Marsh. Joshua Drew Odell. Jamie Lee Gibson Park. Alicia Renee Placer. Elaine M. Poston. Carla M. Price. Jessica Lynn Rice. Daniel Lee Shelford. Daryl Wayne Shrewsbury. Charles Paul Smith. Mary Frances Treadway. Katrina S. Wasmuth. James E. Weed. Kylie Brianne Wells. Stephanie Klosta. The Bachelor of Arts degree has been earned by the following students: Jenna Lynn Gloria Adams, Criminal Justice. Gabriella Azzarello, Chemistry. Jared John Baranowski, History. Sean N. Berger, Theology. Stephen J. Bridgman, History. Tyler Buchan, Criminal Justice. Rachel Eileen Kaja, Liberal Studies, Elementary Education. Caitlin Carpino, English and French, summa cum laude. Broderick Gregory Colliner, English. Kelsey Lynn Crawshaw, Criminal Justice. Lucy DeFruscio, Communications, summa cum laude. Preston M. DeHammer, Philosophy. Francis Dustin Alexander Dudelet, Communications. Corin Ray Early, Liberal Studies, Elementary Education. Sarah Elizabeth Edwards, Communications. Allison Marie Geary, Criminal Justice. Kara Diana Gordon, History, Summa Cum Laude. Janie Beth Hall, Liberal Studies, Elementary Education. Paige Mackenzie Huber, Liberal Studies, Elementary Education, Cum Laude. Joshua David Koenig, Liberal Studies, Elementary Education. Tyler Kowalczyk, Criminal Justice.
Congratulations.
Nicholas Thomas Malarby, History.
Congratulations.
Carla Marquis Mary, Bachelor of Arts, History, Bachelor of Science, Psychology, Cum Laude. Emily Ann McAllister, Liberal Studies, Elementary Education. Michael John McDonald, Liberal Studies, Elementary Education. Daniel McFarland, Communications, Magna Cum Laude. Ashton McKenzie, Philosophy. Nicole Marie Miner, Liberal Studies, Elementary Education, Summa Cum Laude. James Moore, a BA in Chemistry and a BS in Biology. Christian Mubenesha, Chemistry. Christopher T. Munster, Liberal Studies, Elementary Education. Travis J. Nicholas, Criminal Justice. Dylan Hunter Anderko, History and Philosophy. Patrick Murphy O'Neill, Chemistry. Monica Michelle Panaccio, Liberal Studies, Elementary Education. Miranda K. Principe, Criminal Justice. Mackenzie Ripley, Communications. Luke Rowan, Criminal Justice. Derek A. Runkel, Chemistry. Francis Salome, International Studies, Summa Cum Laude. Peter Scharf, Independent Major. Jared David Sims, Liberal Studies, Elementary Education. Courtney Nicole Snyder, Spanish. George Patrick Stanton, English. Cassandra A. Stickel, English. Kyle Michael Tice, Chemistry, cum laude. Cody Ray Thompson, Communications. Luke Titus, Philosophy. Maddie L. Trainer, Communications. Sarah Elaine Truex, Liberal Studies, Elementary Education, cum laude. Erin Elizabeth Underwood, Criminal Justice. Patrick Joseph Washington, English. Jamie Louise Wenger, Liberal Studies, Elementary Education. Matthew Brian Whitehurst, Liberal Studies, Elementary Education, cum laude. Kelsey Jo Zimkowski, Communications.
Thank you very much. Appreciate it.
The Bachelor of Science degree has been earned by the following students. Antonio David Acerno, Athletic Training. James Lynn Allen, Psychology. Kelsey Brooke Atchison, Athletic Training.
Congratulations.
Alex M. Augsburger, Computer Science.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Leanna Begbeni Adietto, Business Administration Accountancy. Charles Bard, Business Administration. Nathaniel Michael Barker, Chemistry, cum laude. Lindsay Adeline Baugh, Psychology, magnum cum laude. Clinton James Bainham, Psychology. Jeffrey C. Becca, Chemistry, magna cum laude. Matthew Ryan Bergman, Physics. Caitlin Boyd, Chemistry. Haley Danielle Brooks, Respiratory Therapy. Mara Patrice Kane, Respiratory Therapy. Nicholas Chauffournier, Computer Science. Monica Cicchella, Biology. Shannon Marie Chisleski, Respiratory Therapy, summa cum laude. Jennifer Marie Klaus, Athletic Training. Brennan Lee Comfort, Physics, cum laude. Cooper Allen Corley, Athletic Training, cum laude.
Congratulations.
Travis Marcel Raymond Couture, Biology. James Leon Davis, Athletic Training. Aaron Scott Dinterman, Accountancy. Tamika Gale Ann Eddy, Psychology. Andrew Everett Eisenhart, Chemistry. Alicia Marie Ernest, Psychology. Elliot Falconer, Business Administration. Victoria Ann Fluharty, Bachelor of Science, Athletic Training, and Bachelor of Arts, History. Shelby Nicole Ford, Psychology. Jared Michael Gillespie, Business Administration. Taylor Danielle Griffith, Athletic Training, magna cum laude. Kayla Paige Gross, Psychology. Madeline Elizabeth Holt, Psychology, cum laude. Andrew Michael Howard, Business Administration, summa cum laude. Colin Hudson, Athletic Training. Nathaniel A. Hupp, Biology. Colin Huth, Biology, magna cum laude. Steffi M. Cabullo, Accountancy, magna cum laude. Jacob Brian Alexander Keeney, Environment and Sustainability. Chelsea Kelly, Athletic Training, cum laude. Frankie Lee Kesner Ranklin, Psychology. Garrett Kedrowski, Computer Science.
Thank you.
Brandon Allen Kimball, Business Administration, Accountancy, cum laude. Jacqueline R. Critchbaum, athletic training, magna cum laude. Aaliyah Kershey, athletic training. Garrett Davidson LaBrosse, accountancy, business administration, cum laude. Melanie K. Lamp, psychology. Kayla Paige Lawson, respiratory therapy, summa cum laude. Hao Chen Li, mathematics. Jennifer Ann Leach, psychology.
Thank you.
Stephanie Michelle Lorenzi, biology. Corey Hunter Luby, business administration. Patrick Joseph Maxwell, accountancy. Helene Kayala Mbangu, business administration, accountancy. Rachel Ann McGuire, psychology. Sydney Marie Menke, respiratory therapy. Jessica Ray Midcap, biology. Kayla S. Mitchell, accountancy. Joseph Michael Molick, Jr., athletic training.
Congratulations. Thank you.
Thomas Edward Moore, biology.
Congratulations.
Philip Mueller, business administration.
Congratulations.
Rami F. Naja, accountancy, business administration. Josephine Wakutsava Nima, accountancy, business administration, magna cum laude. Chardon Sele Nambala, accountancy, business administration. Evan Don Nieswanger, business administration.
Francis Gaborjan,
got it. Congratulations.
Thank you so much for your help.
Francis Gaborjan Owens, accountancy.
Congratulations.
Megan Pape, nuclear medicine technology. Skylar Noel Patton, psychology. Victoria Michelle Piggott, biology. Gabrielle Klein Provenzano, business administration. Megan Elizabeth Reed, psychology. Matthew Gerald Riffle, accountancy, business administration, magna cum laude.
Congratulations.
Emily Davis Robinson, psychology, summa cum laude. Nicolette Robinson, psychology.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Patricia Ann Roper, psychology.
Congratulations.
Janelle Elizabeth Scheigel, biology, magna cum laude. Nathan David Schmidt, accountancy, summa cum laude. Kara Danielle Schrock, accountancy.
Congratulations. Thank you.
Andrew Philip Schuetz, athletic training, cum laude. Shannon Singleton, Nuclear Medicine Technology. David George Stanley, Business Administration, summa cum laude. Caitlin Marie Stanton, Computer Science, cum laude. Lorian Michelle Tharp, respiratory therapy. Prissa Matamba Shimbambe, business administration, cum laude. Casey Christopher Tuttle, business administration, cum laude. Shannon Lynn Walsh, psychology. Tyler Wickett, athletic training, cum laude. Eric Scott Wyant II, business administration, cum laude. Rebecca Jo Ziegler, biology. Yan Zhang, computer science. The Bachelor of Science in Nursing has been awarded to the following students: Andrew Michael Bozomowski. Andrew Scott Clark, cum laude. Brittany E. DiCapio. Caitlin Rebecca DiCola. Caitlin Beth Edge. Riley Dawn Hillam. Carrie L. Jackson. Tyler A. Jordan. Crystal Law Wilson. Hannah Elizabeth Lazuka. Tiffany Lee, summa cum laude. Amy Elizabeth Lilly. Yay!
Michaela Lucky. Jacqueline McLean Mansfield, summa cum laude. Brandon Michael Marshall, cum laude. Natalie Alyssa Morris. Ellery Joanne Patterson, summa cum laude. Rochelle Alyssa Reiser. Cassie Robinson. Tyler Matthew Salco. Hillary Danielle Taylor. Ferdinand Babachu Takaya, cum laude. Jesse James Truhan. Thank you. Olivia Morgan Van Hoos. Victoria Elizabeth Voljanic. Mary Ellen Wright, with distinction. Ashley Elizabeth Zadi, cum laude. The Bachelor of Liberal Arts degree has been awarded to the following students: Ethan Chapman Casey, The Bachelor of Arts for the Ignatian Honor Scholars has been awarded to the following students: Do Hum Chui, Chemistry, summa cum laude. Evan Robert Collins, Bachelor of Arts, IHS Chemistry, Bachelor of Science, Biology, cum laude. Alexa Christine Frankovich, Communications, cum laude. The Bachelor of Science for the Ignatian Honor Scholars has been awarded to the following students: Sarah Elizabeth Book, Biology, cum laude. Sarah Buckley, Athletic Training, cum laude. Katie Renee Livengood, Psychology, magna cum laude. Paola Alejandra Masonette, Psychology, cum laude. The Bachelor of Arts in Organizational Leadership and Development has been awarded to the following students: Sonny R. Berkheimer, with distinction. Rose Burdine, with distinction. Paula Denise Gejo, with distinction. Charlene Gilbert. Krista J. Henderson. Congratulations. Carla Frances Kernan. Darcy Lauren Otto, with distinction. Stacy D. Ruckman, with distinction. The Bachelor of Science in Healthcare Leadership has been awarded to the following student: Donald J. Lessick, Jr. And Melissa Lessick, with distinction. Graduates, please move your tassels. And congratulations to all. At the graduation banquet on Thursday evening, many graduates received awards and recognition for outstanding service in university activities and organizations and for departmental academic achievement. At this time, we will announce those persons who have excelled academically at Wheeling Jesuit University. As I call your name, please stand at your seat to be recognized. The distinction of salutatorian is given to the graduating senior who has completed at Wheeling Jesuit University at least 90 of the required 120 credit hours and has the second highest academic average for those credits. The salutatorian for the class of 2015 is Emily Robinson. The Henry F. Paul medals, given through a bequest of Imelda Afrida Paul, are awarded to the students earning the highest four-year average in all subjects. The candidate for the Bachelor of Arts degree who has achieved the highest four-year average in all subjects this year is Kara Gordon. A Henry F. Paul Medal is awarded to the candidate for the Bachelor of Science degree who has achieved the highest four-year average in all subjects. The medal was awarded to Andrew Howard. Wheeling Jesuit University also awards a silver medal to the candidate for the Bachelor of Arts degree who has achieved the second highest four-year average in all subjects. The winner this year is Francis Salome. Likewise, a silver medal is awarded to the candidate for the Bachelor of Science degree who received the second highest four-year average in all subjects. The medal was awarded this year to Nathan Schmidt. In the Division of Professional and Graduate Studies, two Anthony T. Basil medals are awarded. For having earned the highest general average, the medal was awarded to Marin Addy. And for having earned the second highest general average, a medal was awarded to Tiffany Lee. The Russell E. Yunkins Medal is given by his family in memory of a man who cared deeply about the development of an MBA program at Wheeling Jesuit University. The medal honors the Master's in a Business Administration degree recipient who graduates first in the class. The Russell E. Yunkins Medal this year was awarded to Scott Russell. The Mark W. Bischoff Medal is given by his family in memory of a man who had a lifelong dedication to education and was a graduate of the MSA program at Wheeling Jesuit University. The medal was awarded by his wife, Dr. Janet Bischoff, a member of our nursing department, and honors the graduating student with the highest grade average in the Master of Accountancy program. This year, the award went to Allison Miller. The next set of honors are presented in this ceremony, and as your name is called, please come forward to receive your award. The Frank R. Administration. This year, the Swint Medal is awarded to Patrick Washington. The distinction of valedictorian is given to the graduating senior who has completed at Wheeling Jesuit University at least 90 of the required 120 credit hours for graduation and has the highest academic average for those credits. The valedictorian for the class of 2015 is Andrew Howard. Andrew, the podium is yours.
I wanted to first start off by saying I'm really in awe by all the distinctions I've seen today. I wish I could say I was speechless because then I wouldn't have to come up here and embarrass myself. But it's absolutely amazing seeing everybody here and having the honor of being able to speak to you today. I'd like to keep this short just because I know everybody here wants to get out of here, so do I. I want to start off by giving some much-needed and well-deserved thank yous. I'd like to first and foremost thank God for where I am today. There's no way I'd be where I am in my crazy life without some divine intervention. Next, I'd like to thank my mother. If you don't know, my mother was suddenly and surprisingly diagnosed with terminal pancreatic cancer shortly after arriving here my freshman year. She was only given 3 months to live, but she struggled and succeeded in living three times longer than that in order to reach her 50th birthday and 25th wedding anniversary. Although she passed away after my freshman year, she's been the single biggest motivator in achieving all my goals. Thank you. I'd also like to thank my father, who held my family together during our hard times. Taking on the responsibilities of what my mother did for our family of six kids on top of being a father, there's no award big enough for that, so thank you. Thank you. Thank you also to my family and friends, whether it was cooking me dinner or fixing my car for me Every little thing that you've done to help me along the way, it's built me up to where I am today, so I wouldn't be here without my family and friends. I also have to give a few shout-outs to some fellow students out there. They were my high school buddies, and now we're graduating together. Most of us, anyway. Fellow graduate Dohoom Choi, piano man and chemistry tutor. I also have to give a shout-out to fellow graduate David Stanley. He's been my partner in crime in the business department. Congrats, dude. And then finally, I have to give a shout-out to Harry Lee, my nocturnal roommate and best friend. Thank you. I'd also like to thank the professors, not necessarily for cramming every last case study, group presentation, and research project from the syllabus during Dead Week, which I've been told is where we have time to study for our finals. We wouldn't know that at WJU. In fact, on behalf of the graduates before you, I'd like to say you're welcome because they did it, and they also took their finals, and they're amazing. However, before my grades get changed, and I have to stay here another year because I'm ripping on teachers, I'd like to thank the professors for always pushing us to be better and being there for us outside of the classroom when we were really challenged. I know I wasn't an easy student to work with, so thanks for putting up with me. I also really appreciated that my teachers were there for me during and after the complications with my mother. That means more to me than you know, so give it up to the professors. My last thank you as a college student, and it's a huge thank you, it has to go to coffee, because I wouldn't be here and this speech wouldn't have been written without coffee. You're the real MVP. So on to the actual message of my speech. There have been a lot of trending challenges over the years while we've been here at Wheeling Jesuit, and a lot of them, to put it bluntly, were stupid and impossible to achieve on purpose. But my challenge today is something that I don't believe is that hard. My speech is about the challenge to be greater than a valedictorian. Don't get me wrong, getting this award took a lot of hard work. All of you graduates here today put in a lot of hard work to get your degrees and awards from this institution, and you deserve them. There isn't a problem with earning those awards and degrees. Like I said, I'm in awe that I just get to speak in front of you. Our rigorous education will prepare us for the challenges of the world. It's the tool we'll use in achieving greatness in our lives. The problem, however, arises if we become satisfied with only receiving an education, if that's our highest mark in life. Being valedictorian is a great honor, but after really thinking about it, I realized it's something that you do to help yourself. It'll help me to get a job and to get into graduate school, but in the grand scheme of things, it doesn't mean anything. If I said that my greatest achievement in life was being valedictorian, then I didn't live a life worth remembering because I'd only helped myself. But I'll tell you what really matters. What really matters is impacting the lives of others. To change the world, as they say, and as everyone hopes to do in some way, means having to change the lives of others in the world to truly be men and women for others. And to those of you who really did impact and help others here at WJU, I commend you. Serving the community, or going on a mission trip like I had the privilege of in Honduras, or seriously, even just helping out your friends when they really needed it, all of those things are much better than being able to stand up here and give a speech. But we still can't be satisfied with that. Although some say the best years of our lives are in high school or maybe in college, I truly believe the best years of our lives are the ones that are ahead of us. That is, as long as we're never satisfied, as long as we keep setting our goals higher, as long as we help others, our true successes in life. And we'll have so many opportunities to do that. The key, though, isn't taking advantage of each opportunity as if it were our last. My mom was one of the greatest examples of that, and I hope to impact half the people she did in the time she was given. In describing her legacy, I think about a quote from Bruce Lee when he once said, "The key to immortality is first living a life worth remembering." As you change the world and impact others around you, they'll be the ones who carry on your legacy for you. I know that all the awards, all the diplomas, all those material things will disintegrate at some point and they'll become nothing, but I promise your legacies won't. Lastly, which I know all students love to hear because that means it's almost time to go, I want to give all you guys a hand, not only for the hard work you've put in here at Wheeling Jesuit, which really is something, but also for the even harder work you're going to put into becoming even greater men and women for others, and into forging a legacy that's so much better than any academic award. Thank you for the great ride, and let's go Cards 2015.
Thank you, Andrew. In celebration of the 50th anniversary of the graduating class of 1965 from Wheeling College, I would like to call upon John Letzkus, a member of the class of 1965, to come forward and share a special message with you today from the Alumni Association.
Good afternoon, Reverend Fathers, fellow educators, parents of the class of 2015, distinguished guests, class of 2015. Welcome to you all. It's great to be here. Heck, at my age, it's great to be anywhere. Through time, a traditional form has evolved for this type of speech, which is some old fart, his best years behind him, who over the years has made a lot of lousy decisions, that'd be me, gets to stand up in front of you folks and give heartfelt advice to a group of shining, energetic young people with most of their lives yet in front of them. That would be you. As my class, the class of 65, approaches its 50th reunion, my thoughts harken back to the 16th day of May, 1965, when we were in your position. As a math major, I've had a tough time trying to wrap my mind around what 50 years is. It's 18,253 days ago. That means I've been asleep for 17 years. Poor me, I'm still a little tired. But we're here to celebrate your common history, knowing that in the last 4 years, your decisions, beliefs, talents, and personalities were shaped, colored, and impacted by the values you've learned and by your experiences and interactions with your teachers and friends. These influences are part of what we are today, and those of you who have graduated are here to honor and acknowledge the importance those years have had in your lives. Wheeling College was my second home for 4 years. It was a comfortable space where I could be myself in the company of others like me and absorb most of the information that came my way. But for all of us, that afternoon was the culmination of the first stage of our lives and represented an important part of our step into adulthood. The motto, "Luceat lux vestra," was emphasized in everything we did. Our teachers and our mentors were living examples of the knowledge, respect, and dedication to that motto. They were missionaries serving the honorable task of educating us. Even though we were focused on learning, it didn't mean that we couldn't have some fun. We were rambunctious, mischievous, accident-prone risk-takers, and I wound up with a lot of time in the dean's office. The class of 2015, I say to you, this is the last time all of you will walk this campus as a class. We graduated, formed families, and something happened that we hadn't foreseen. We were creating a very strong and most precious bond of friendship, a relationship so special that it doesn't matter how many years pass between the times we see each other, because the moment we reestablish contact, it's like being here all over again. We made so many good, lifelong friends within our class, and those people are a continuing source of happiness that helps keep our spirits high. Friendship is a difficult term to understand. It means a lot of different things to a lot of different people, but it always fills your heart with pleasure, and it makes you feel connected, so that even after 50 years, we are all able to feel each other's joys and sorrows. Many years ago, we danced together, we played together, we celebrated our coming of age, and we graduated together. Graduates, you need to keep doing this and keep doing what those who preceded you have done. Rejoice in each other and each other's company. You need to keep feeding and grooming the friendships that were born during your years here at Wheeling Jesuit University. So graduates, in closing, I say to you, do all you can with what you have, in the time that you have, in the place that you are. I look forward to watching all of you succeed in your lives and in your careers. I thank you very much for allowing me the singular honor of being here this afternoon. And to the class of 2015, I want to welcome you to the Wheeling Jesuit University alumni family. Thank you very much.
The Wheeling Jesuit Chamber Singers and the Music Ministry Choir, directed by Mr. Robert Traeger, will at this time present Prayer for a Safe Journey.
This be our blessing.
To close our graduation ceremony, I call upon Monsignor Kevin Quirk, Assistant to the Bishop and Judicial Vicar for the Diocese of Wheeling-Charleston, to give the benediction. We will recess after the benediction, and I ask that the audience remain at your seats until the faculty and students have left the building. Please rise. Let us pray. Almighty ever-living God, we give thanks to you for these graduates whom your love realized in the support of family, the care of professors, and the encouragement of friends has brought to this moment. Their achievements and the hopes they embody are signs to us of your love. As they go forth this day, Father, help them with the light of your Holy Spirit to seek your will in all things. Guide their feet to walk always in your way. Strengthen their hands to accomplish works of justice and mercy. Give light to their eyes to see the spark of divine life in every person whom they meet. Enlarge their hearts with the love of Christ to serve the poor and care for the needy. Father, cause these graduates to do all for your glory, seeking nothing more than the privilege of being your servants, ambassadors of your peace, instruments of worship in the world, and ministers of your word. Remind them always to allow the light of Christ, rich as it is, to dwell in their hearts, burn brightly in their minds, and inflame their every action, so that it may shine brightly before the world. We ask this, as we ask all things, through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. That is the conclusion of our graduation ceremony.